I'll say it again. Everybody has been tested. Everybody has been tempted. Everybody has been tried. And I use the word prove because God told you to prove the deacons. Yeah. So everybody has to be tested, tempted, tried, and proven. And if you don't pass the test, you don't go to the next level. God said, we go from faith to faith. And I'm not upset with anybody, angry with anybody. I look at people sometimes and I said, I look at them and they let the devil, like he's got a ring in their nose, pulling them to disaster, pulling them to destruction. He's just plainly leading them. And you know what they're only doing the same things over they did before. They ain't doing nothing new. They're doing the same old things over again. Why, if God's blessing you, would you do the same things over again? But they do it, and I look at them and see them do it. And sometimes I just feel sorry for them. Sometimes I don't want to talk to them. I just like to look the other way. How bad off can you be? I ain't gonna put the we in there, because there's a period of time that everybody makes mistakes, but there goes a period of time you're supposed to grow up.
Amen.
God told you to grow in grace and in knowledge, is that right?
Amen.
So if you're growing in grace and knowledge, why would you keep repeating the same thing? Why would you be so intense about what people think and care? Why are you so out to fulfill making them feel good about you?
Amen.
When God has already given you a special place.
Amen. Thank you, God.
All right, I want you to come up beside me, Diane. Bring your tablet. Okay, I want us to read Ecclesiastes 3:15, and I want to read in about two or three different versions, because I want you to hear it. He's going to do it in the regular, the amplified, and she's going to do it in the living, in the new transition, whatever you call that. Translation. I got it. All right, you ready, Brother Green? Let's read it. Ecclesiastes 3:15, because you know what, people? There's nothing new under the sun. And so why would you keep repeating things that's already been explained to you, and you keep doing it, and then have a nerve and want God to keep blessing you? And that's the part, God, why am I praying or fasting and stretching out for people that just do the same old, same old? But I got a feeling, hallelujah, in everything, because Jesus done told me. Come on, read, Brother Green.
Ecclesiastes 3:15 in the King James Version. That which hath been is now, and that which is to be have already been. And God requires it, that which is past.
Go ahead.
In the Amplified. That which is now already has been, and that which is to be already has been. And God seeks that which has passed by, so that history repeats itself.
Why do you want to let history repeat yourself? That which is natural is first, right?
Amen.
Did the Israelites not do it?
Amen.
Then my God, what? It's the Bible was written 4 times written for your learning. So you don't make the same mistakes, you have hope. Then my God, why do you turn around and do it again? You're just repeating history over and over and over again. And I'm looking at you and I'm saying, oh my God, what's the matter here? Why would you do it again? And you know what? I'm stopping giving information, advice. I'll give it across the pulpit. And so therefore, for now, you know what? Don't need to ask me. Because like I told my daughter, I said, no, you pray. Because there's got to come a time, you got to know how to get in touch with God and make some right decisions for yourself. And if you keep messing up, well, then you are going to pay for it and wonder why you're not getting anywhere. Why? Because you keep repeating the same thing over again that's already been done.
Amen.
Come on, read, please.
3:15, it says, what is happening now has happened before.
What you're doing now done been there before. Come on.
And what will happen in the future has happened before.
So the future's coming, and you're going to do the same thing in the future that's already been done in the past.
Because God makes the same things happen over and over again.
You're going to be tempted and tried over and over. Are y'all hearing me? And how many are passing the test? Hello?
Amen.
You got to be tested. You got to be tried. How many are passing? Come on, read.
I also noticed that under the sun there's...
No. Give me another version.
Another version?
Yeah, the living. Now that was the living. Give me the new transit, new whatever. The new living or the whatever one. So people, I want you to know, and I'm taking my time, it's coming back again. And when you're tried, are you going to be like Job? How are you going to come forth? As a failure? Oh, I just want to do this so bad, and once it's done, how do you feel about what you did? When it's done, you should feel good about it. You should feel that you have exalted God. You should feel that you pleased Him and made Him happy. Because when you make God happy, He flexes His muscles. And when He flexes His muscles, out come your blessings. Hallelujah. Out comes your promotion. No, no, my child. Are y'all hearing me? But when you get finished with the other, how far promoted are you? What did you get? What can you care back on paper, words, thoughts, pictures. I mean, come on now. What are you taking back? And after a few days, it's over. Even the elation is gone. Come on, read.
This one says, whatever is has been before, and what is now, because, and what is to be is now, because God makes search for the things which are past.
He's searching, and the things that he used in the past to tempt people, he's still using them now. Got another version? One more. There's nothing new under the sun. Nothing, people. You don't need to be tricked because it's already been done before us. So all you need to do is make sure you're not found there anymore. Look at the word and read. That's why I was saying study to show yourself approved. Go ahead.
That which is already has been, that which is to be already has been, and God seeks what has been driven away.
So he's still seeking. He's seeking. And so, you know, like I said, you're going to be tempted. You're going to be tried. You're going to be tested to be proven, and there's nothing you can do about it. Death and life is in the power of what? So one main thing that's got to get tested is your mouth.
Yes.
That's one of them, is your mouth. Some people talk too much, they tell too much. You know, the Bible said a fool is kind of wise when he do what?
Holds his peace.
Holds his peace. Some meetings I have, I'm not with some people in them, because before I can tell it, they done told somebody. You know, it shouldn't be that way. But let's go to, let's go to the fifth verse and read 2 and 6. Because people, nobody, you said, well, if they hadn't been for them, I wouldn't have messed up. No. You did it yourself. Nobody can destroy you more than you can destroy yourself. You are your worst enemy. I'm trying to teach you to become your own friend. Are you hearing me? God said, I'm your friend. But you need to become a friend to yourself. Because if you lay your life down for yourself to please God, you become your friend. But if you don't, you become your enemy. The enemy in me is destroying me. Are you hearing me? Your enemy in you is what's doing it to you. So don't blame nobody else. You look at what you want out of these eyes. You say what you want out of this mouth. And you hear what you want. Are you hearing me? And when I hear too much junk, I can't take it. But some people have a good time here. Don't bother them. Come on, read, please. Brother Green.
5 and 2. Be not rash with thy mouth, and let not thy heart be hasty to utter anything before God. For God is in heaven, and thou upon earth. Therefore, let thy words be few.
The Bible said, be swift to hear. You got people that they just can't help themselves. Their mouth is running like a motorboat. But you got to realize, slow to speak, swift to hear. Okay, let's fall down to verse 6.
Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin, neither say thou before the angel that it was an error. Wherefore should God be angry at thy voice and destroy the work of thine hands?
And so you wonder, I'm working and I'm toiling, but why am I not getting anywhere? Because you are destroying it yourself. Nobody's doing it but you. I can't imagine the things that some people do with what God's done for them, what God's done brought them, that they would do this thing. Some things is almost incomprehensible to me. It's just totally incomprehensible, you see, because you're the one that needs help. God don't need help, you need help. So you got to do what God says do in order to get God's help, because you ain't making him do it. He wants to do it.
Hallelujah.
He wants to help you. He wants to bless you. He wants to deliver you. He wants to exalt you. He wants to promote you. He wants to make you better than you ever could be. But the only person standing between it is you. Is you and what you do and the way you do it. And if you think I'm going to fuss with you, I'm not going to fuss with you. I'm going to give you the word. You think I'm going to come up and tell you like I used to. Why did you? No, I ain't going to do that. I'm going to let you just go ahead and butt. But then again, when you look around, they leave you saying nothing to me because I didn't do it. Okay, let's hear what you got to say. And then you can, I'm not going to go all the way through. I'm just doing these couple of verses. Go ahead. Yes.
2, don't make rash promises and don't be hasty in bringing matters before God. After all, God is in heaven and you are here on earth. So let your words be few.
Even when you go to talk to God, just like Peter, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. And ran like I don't know what. Watch what you say to God. He's going to try you on it.
Yes.
Was Peter tried?
Yes.
Did he fail?
Yes.
Y'all being tried? Don't answer me if you're failing. Because I don't want to know it. I already know. You got to tell me. Watch what you say to God. Because you're going to be tried. You're going to be tested. He ain't going to let you by. He came out of your mouth. Am I preaching the new gospel? No, I'm preaching the same one. Okay, come on. The
6. Don't let your mouth make you sin, and don't defend yourself by telling the typical
message. Didn't I tell people don't defend themselves? Sometimes I used to fight with people. You know what? I don't hardly hold a conversation with them. I say a few words, I'm off the phone with them. Because they don't have seemingly have enough knowledge to know when they defend themselves. My God, you don't have enough knowledge to know when you defended yourself. What am I wasting my time for? What am I wasting my time for? God said, don't do it. And you want, well, I just thought, no, don't think. Do what the Bible says. It's God that's supposed to defend you. Are y'all hearing me? Well, I wanted you to know. Why you want me to know? I ain't your God. I'm not the one that has to know. I'm not the one that's going to repay you. God said, I'm going to repay. Isn't that what he said? Amen. So then what you want me to know for? I'm going to know so much whether you tell me or not. I'm going to look at what you do and hear what you say. That tells me the story. You don't need to tell me nothing else. Okay, come on, read.
Don't let your mouth make you sin, and don't defend yourself by telling the temple messenger that the promise you made was a mistake. That would make God angry, and he might wipe out everything you have achieved.
I don't want that to happen to anybody. I don't want to see that happen to anybody. So if I can get y'all to listen to me and wake up to reality, then there's still hope. There's still hope. Because the person that will use up in the morning. But after a while, they're going to run out too. Are you hearing me? All good things come to an end, and God is good. Okay, now I'm going to talk about your father, Abraham. You can sit down, my name. We're going to go to Genesis. The first one I should go to is Genesis 21. No, but I'm going to go to Genesis 17. I'm going to start at Genesis 17. No. Give me Job 23:10. Because I'm laying a foundation and I'm basing it. You can tape it or to tape it, because ain't nowhere under the sun you're going to remember all I'm saying today. You ain't going to remember, because I got too much dope. I mean, I could have kept going and on and on, because I tell you, every time I woke up, I heard God talking. Every time I woke up, I heard God talking. Hallelujah! And it came all from Diane coming home yesterday afternoon. It all started from her coming home. And from that, he poured out a message to me. And the message was going on even through the night. Are you hearing me? Glory to God. He can get a message out of what you think ain't not a message. God can bring greatness out of chaos. He can bring light out of darkness. That's the kind of God we serve. He can bring riches out of poverty. That's the kind of God we serve. He can bring healing out of a sick body. Why? Because healing's already in there. You hear me? If he's in there, prosperity's already. You just got the faith to bring it out. All right, let's look at Job 23:10. I love living this kind of life. I'm living a blessed life.
But he knoweth the way that I take.
He already knows the way you take. He ain't crazy.
And when he had tried me, I shall come forth as gold.
Some people say pure gold. Ain't no pure in there. But how you, when you tried, tell me what you going to come forth as. No, you don't want to tell me. That's all right. Put out on your paper. You should have a paper and a pad. You should have everything. And listen, you write these things down and go home and lay them down. And when I come back on Wednesday night, you don't know nothing. So I don't care if you write them down. It's up to you, because you're the one that's got to do this. And you can't do this like you want to with a phone. You need a Bible, a pencil, and a pad, or even a tape recorder. Because you know you aren't capable of holding what I'm saying. And the ones that don't hold it is the ones that really need it. Okay. All right. When he knows you, and now when the time comes and you are tried, because that's what we're going to deal with trials today, and I want you to evaluate how you handled your trials so that you can receive your promotion. Mm-hmm. If you have handled your trials, you deserve to be promoted. If you haven't handled them, then where's your promotion coming from? Promotion comes from the east to the west. Promotion comes from God. Uh-huh. So if you do it right, God gonna promote you. That's why I know what you ain't doing, because the word has got to be for. I know it's got to be fulfilled. Okay, so let's go to Genesis. We're gonna start with Father Abraham. Father Abraham.
Jim. I'm for you.
Okay, Father Abraham. Father Abraham. So we all the children, if we say the what? Father Abraham. Okay, so we're going to start with our Father Abraham. Where all these riches and blessings come from, right? Okay, let's go to Genesis 17 chapter, and let's start at the first I want you to read the first and the second verse of Genesis. We're going to follow Abraham. This is our grandfather. This is our history. No, this ain't our grandfather. He's our father. But this is where your history is. And if you're going to be delivered, if you're going to prosper, you got to do it through Abraham. And why? Because he had faith. And without faith, it is impossible to do what? So the reason he is your father, because he's the father of faith. Are you hearing me? So you got to have the faith of Abraham. Okay, so let's, now when we read 17:1, God telling Abraham that what he is, and if he walks before him and do all these things, God's going to bless him. Come on, read.
And when Abram was 90 years old and nigh, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. 2. And I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly.
Now drop down to verse, what did I say? To verse 7.
And I will establish my covenant.
I will establish my what?
Covenant.
Now, a covenant is agreement that God will not break. When God said, I'm going to establish a covenant, the only way I can break that covenant is I'm going to die, and God ain't dying. Are you hearing me? It's a covenant that cannot be revoked. I am making an unevocable covenant with you, Abraham, and I will fulfill my part. And if I don't fulfill it, I have to die. Since God can't die, it's got to be fulfilled. And since God can't lie, he's got to bring it to pass. Are you hearing me?
Hallelujah.
Okay, read.
And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed after thee, and their generations for an everlasting covenant.
For what? Everlasting. This covenant never ceases to be. As long as the world stands, this covenant will always be enforced. And so therefore, I can step up because I am. Hallelujah. I'm a seed of Abraham. So this covenant belongs to me.
Hallelujah.
It belongs to you too. But you got to have it by faith. If you can't get the faith to walk in it, then you can't have the faith to maintain it or receive from it. It's by faith. Okay, come on, read.
For an everlasting covenant to be a God unto thee, and to do thy and to thy seed after thee.
And so, are we the seed of Abraham?
Yes.
We're supposed to be, right?
Yes.
Are we supposed to be?
Yes.
Okay, so it says, for your seed after you. So God is making Abraham a promise. That same promise goes to all of us. And so now we're going to move down. Let me see what I want to do now. Okay, let's move to 22:1 in Genesis, and now let's watch Abraham as God proceeds to test him that he might bring this covenant into existence. He promised it to him. I shouldn't go there first. Wait a minute. Let's go to 21. Let's go to Genesis 21 first, and then we'll go to 22. And let's see 10 through 14. Okay, go ahead.
Wherefore she said unto Abraham, cast out this bondswoman and her son.
Now you know that his wife told him to get that bondwoman, right?
Yes.
It wasn't his idea, it was her idea. And so he did what his wife said, right? Because he probably wanted to do it. So he did it. That's right, he did it. Go ahead.
Which she said unto him, unto Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, even with Isaac. And the thing was very grievous in Abraham's sight because of his son.
Now, that was his son, his first son. But God's not going to count this as his first son because God didn't tell him to do it. And so therefore, he's grieved. Go ahead.
And God said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad, and because of thy bondwoman. And all that Sarah hath said unto thee, hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called.
You listen to it again, so now listen to what she said, get rid of it. All right, come on.
And also of the son of the bondwoman will I make a nation, because he is thy seed. Verse 14. And Abraham rose up early in the morning, and took bread and a bottle of water, and gave it unto Hagar, putting it on her shoulder, and the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba.
He put his child and her out in the desert. Don't you know that took faith? Because he didn't know what was going to happen. He ain't seen, he ain't never known God to do this. This is totally new to him. So therefore, he had to do it by what? You see him giving God a problem. You see him telling God, oh God, this is my son. How can you, and you see him giving God, do you think God, when he tells you to do something, that he's interested in what you got to say? He's interested in watching you do what?
Do it.
Obey him. By what? By faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. How many of y'all can say that? No, don't answer me. I want you to think about what Abraham went through in order for you to have the promise you had today. The man had to give up. He had to give up. He had to turn loose. He had to separate. He had to obey. And he had to learn to shut his mouth. Are you hearing me? Amen. How many of you all have learned to conquer your mouth? How many of you learned to say nothing? You just got to say a little something, you know, and throw everything into it. Not Abraham. He had enough sense to know, I'm not going to say anything. Amen. So he did what God told him. Yes. So therefore, he was tried, wasn't he?
Yes.
Did he come forth as?
Oh.
I'm not going to tell you what. I'm going to say different ones. You're going to find out what's tempted, what's tried. Don't bring it back to me. Just whatever you find, you do. Okay, now, let's go to Genesis 22. We're going to move on in the life of Abraham. That's why I'm saying there's nowhere in the world you're going to keep all this in your mind. And so you can't write it down and keep up with me, because while you write, you're missing something I'm saying, because your brain ain't that functional. And don't tell me this, because it ain't. So you're going to catch something, miss something, and you say, oh, I didn't hear that before. I know that's the truth. Okay, Abraham, Genesis 22 and 1. I want you to read 1 through 3.
And it came to pass, after these things, that God did tempt Abraham.
Now, God did what?
Tempt Abraham.
Well, they said God don't tempt nobody. Yes, he does. You just got to get an understanding. God does tempt you. God tempts all of us. And he's going to keep on tempting you too. And Abraham was tempted till the day he died, and you're going to be tempted too. But how are you failing, or how are you progressing? Come on, read.
And God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham. And he said, behold, here I am. And he said, take now thy son, thy only son Isaac.
Coming back for the one. The other one he didn't really recognize. But this, he says, your only son. That means he recognized the other one, right?
Yes.
But he knew this was Abraham's heartbeat, right?
Yes.
But he had a plan set up. He needs somebody with enough faith to help him carry out his plan. Yes. So here comes a man of faith, which makes him your father, who blessed God to carry out the plan. Come on, read.
Then take now thy son, thy only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of.
All right, that's verse 3.
I'm in verse 3 now.
Okay.
And Abraham rose up early in the morning.
That same thing he did before. He rose up where?
Early in the morning.
He got up early. Some of y'all get up in the morning and y'all get dressed, get out of the house. You don't talk to God, don't say nothing to God, don't pay no attention to God, don't pay no time to God. You in a hurry. Where do you think you're going without spending time with God when you get up in the morning? When your feet hit the floor, your knees ought to hit it too. Spending some time with God. Don't get up 5 minutes before getting out of the house. Forget it. When you wake up in the morning, your feet hit the floor. If you let your knees hit it too, which is a type of worship. God, Mama Shia, I worship you that you let me come into your day. You didn't have to do it, but thank God for your mercy. My God, I thank you that I have eyes to see and ears to hear. But most of all, God, I thank you. I got spiritual life. I got new life. Hallelujah. Springing up in me. Glory to God today. Hallelujah, God. I'm going to have a revelation knowledge. The day you're going to tell me who I can help. The day you're going to tell me how I can bleed. The day you're going to tell me how I can make you feel good. Today, glory be to God. I'm going to enjoy your life because I'm going to draw water out of the wells of salvation. I'm going to draw revelation.
Hallelujah.
The fact that I woke up, I ain't waking up just to go to no job. I'm not waking up just to go through down. I'm waking up to the glory of God. If you don't know how to talk to him, I can't help it. But the Holy Ghost should teach you. Nobody didn't have to teach me, but I thank God that God inside of me opened up my mouth and he prayed for me and through me. He can do the same thing for you because he loves you just like he loves me. But don't go out your house without spending time with God. And you are to have families and children. You ought to get up and have prayer with you in the morning. I don't care if you got to go out 5 o'clock in the morning. And I don't mean just the husband. I mean the husband, the wife, the whole family. You're supposed to be connected.
Yes.
You don't have to clap your hands because probably part of y'all ain't doing it, so that's fine. But anyhow, let's drop down to 12, to verse 12. Read verse 12.
And he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him, for now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thy only son, from me.
So now, here's the fear, the reverential fear of God, right? He said, now I know you reverentially what? Fear me. Now I know I have control of you. Now I know you worship me. Now I know anything I tell you to do, you will what? Do it. Now I know I'm your Lord. I know it. He knew it all the time. He just had to get him to do it so it'd be beneficial for you and for me.
Go put some cold wood on your face.
Okay. All right. Drop down to verse 15 through 18.
And the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time and said, by myself have I sworn, said the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thy only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying, I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. Verse 18. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed.
Now Jesus was the typical type of seed he was talking about. He's going to do what?
Bless all, and in thy seed?
He's going to do what? The gate of his enemy?
Okay. He shall possess the gate of his enemies.
And so, you know what? He went in hell, didn't he?
Amen.
That's what he's talking about. But I ain't going through all that because that's not what I'm trying to get over. I tell you the revelation now doesn't do you no good anyway. I want you to live right. So, give you all this knowledge and you ain't doing nothing with it. It makes you feel good, but it don't do any good. So, I want you to get what you need to get. But he's talking about Jesus Christ. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Okay. So, read verse 18.
And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice.
Now listen, people, you must be able to do what God says, and without any lip service, out of any saying anything back, as long as I'll say, yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way, I'll say, yes, Lord, yes, and what? And I will trust you and obey. That's what you're supposed to do. He don't need you telling him. He's telling you. He created you. You did not create him. He knows how to get you to where you need to go. He knows how to get his program up. So now we're going to move because I'm going to hook these up for you. Now let's go to Hebrews 11 and 17. And if you put them together like I've given them to you, you're not going to be able to miss what I'm saying. Because people, you're supposed to study this book. So I'm changing. I'm making some changes. I'm cutting some stuff out. Because with all of that, doing all of that, I see people still doing what they want to do. Well, you got a right to do what you want to do because God gave you that right. You got a right to live like you want to live because God gave you that too. And so therefore, after you've been here for 5 years, my pastor gave you 5 years. After 5 years, you haven't gotten to the place that you're ready to surrender, then that's going to be between you and God. Okay, let's read Hebrews 11, 17.
By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered...
By faith, when he was what now?
Tried.
He was tempted then, but tempted was nothing. He was tried. He was tried. What did he do?
Offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son.
So he offered up his only what?
Begotten son.
He did it. And so by what? How do you do it? By faith?
By faith.
The only way you can be the child of Abraham is you got to live by what?
Faith.
Without faith, impossible to please God. You don't have to see it. You don't have to know how the outcome is going to be. You don't have to know how a person's going to treat you. You don't have to know how the person's going to feel. Your ambition should be what God says and how God feels, not how somebody else feels, not how somebody else thinks, not how they look at it, but how does God look at it? And he didn't take the time to tell Sarah even. Because it all hinged on the head of the household. Are y'all hearing me?
Amen.
Amen. And so therefore, God tried him and he came out as what? Now let's look at two more places about Abraham, and then I'm going to move on to my next character because I want to show you one that passed all the tests, and I want to show you one that didn't pass it. All right? Amen. Amen. Let's go back to Genesis 21, 10 through 14. You say, how do you get all this hooked up? The Holy Ghost hooks it up.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost will talk to you. Where's the revelation? You know, I'm amazed that I preach to people and teach people and come to find out they don't know what I'm talking about. How in the name of God do you have the Holy Ghost that don't know what the Holy Ghost is talking about? Now, there may be some revelations you ain't ever heard. And wow, I ain't heard that before, but that don't mean you shouldn't get it. Once it's told it and to you, what's stopping you from getting it? What's in your way? Because the Holy Ghost bears witness with itself. And so if it's in you and you ain't getting it, there's something clogging up your line. Whatever's going through your eye gates, your ear gates, or coming out your mouth gates and your heart gate is clogging up your line. Or in your thought process is clogging up your line. All right. Read 21. Let's read 10 through 14, please.
Wherefore she said unto Abraham, cast out this bondwoman.
Oh, we did that one, didn't we?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Let's go to 25, 1 through 6, please. You know what I missed? I got what I missed. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Genesis 24. That's what we did. Genesis 24. I got to stand with my paper here. Genesis 24. Verse 1, and then skip down to 34, but verse 1.
And Abraham was old and well stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things.
God had did what for Abraham?
Blessed him in all things.
And what?
All things.
Don't you know, God, you got people in the body of Christ getting old and ain't blessed with nothing harder. They living in the crappy-dated houses. They got all broke down cars. They live in the cheated, run-down neighborhoods. Come on now. And they got nothing in the bank hardly. They barely making it, living off of Social Security. Get off of here. God ain't never meant for you to live off of Social Security. Amen. I don't care if I'm hitting you, I'm going to hit you and slap you again. He ain't meant for you to live off of Social Security. You live off of Social Security because you're a hardhead. And you don't believe God, you don't walk by faith. God never tied you into a system. You're in the kingdom of God. There is no shortage in heaven. Ain't clap. Don't have to clap. You don't want it. It's the truth anyhow. You ain't got no business being tied down to no little bit of money.
Amen.
God blessed your father in what?
All.
He blessed him. He was old. He was old. But he was blessed in every single thing. Is he your father? Hey, watch out. Don't let me say who might be your father. Because that's who you're supposed to be. And you ain't got to wait till you get old. He wasn't old when he got there. God started blessing before he got old. So by the time he got old, he was so loaded. The man was so loaded. By the time you get old, you ought to be so loaded. With everything. And not missing anything. Nothing missing. Now wait a minute. What happened before? It's going to come around again. Did we read that in the beginning?
Yes, ma'am.
So God means for it to come around from your father back to you. But how much faith do you have to receive it? You say, well, Pastor, you drive a nice car. Did you buy it for me?
No.
Did you buy it for me?
No.
Hallelujah. So at least you can say, Pastor, we bought you that nice car. That's why you're riding in it. No, you didn't. I might have bought the one you're riding. Because I'm loaded, but I didn't get loaded off of you. And you shouldn't get loaded off of me. Are you hearing me? Listen, people, I'm telling you the truth. I should be the one loading you up. You should be the one loading me up. You know what? I'm going to break in here just for a moment. Let's go to Ecclesiastes. People, listen. You should know enough Bible to know who's supposed to help establish what you got. And don't be looking at me, and don't be looking at your sister or your brother either. Look at this word and see what it says. Okay, you got Ecclesiastes, the second chapter? Come on up here, Diane. I'm going to take time to put this in here again. Because I don't want no... Didn't I tell you two things I want to have in this church?
Yes.
I'm working on it. And it's working on you too. Hallelujah! Ecclesiastes, I want this read out of my... Okay, Ecclesiastes 2:26.
Amen.
I want him if he ever gets started.
For God giveth to a man that is good in his sight wisdom and knowledge and joy. But to the sinner he giveth travail to gather and to heap up that he may give to them that is good before God. This also is vanity and vexation of spirit.
So who's supposed to give you your money?
Sinner.
Who's supposed to give you your money?
Sinner.
Then what you, hey, y'all looking the wrong way. They supposed to lay it up for you and have it all ready for you. The wealth of the what? Is laid up for the who? Oh, I ain't got to go that one. Y'all know that one real good, don't you? Okay, go ahead and read it down here.
God gives wisdom, knowledge, and joy to those who please him. But if a sinner becomes wealthy, God takes the wealth away and gives it to those who please him.
He literally takes it away and gives it to you. But he ain't even knowing that, is he? Because you ain't father Abraham. Where did Abraham? Hey, let's go back and watch Abraham. Let's go back to Abraham and let's see how Abraham got his riches. Listen, we're going to follow this up. I'm going to take my time. The 13th chapter of Genesis, I'm going to take my time because people, you got to get this because it don't make sense. You've been in church 20, 30, 40, 50. No. And you're still struggling? That's a slap in God's face. So I don't want to cut my phone off and don't answer when people call me. Because I like to be nice. But it's about time you got this book and wised up. Okay, Genesis 13 chapter, first verse, read it.
Abram went up out of Egypt, he and his wife, and all that he had, and Lot with him, into the south. And Abram was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold.
Where did he get it from?
Egypt.
Egypt. What was Egypt considered?
The world.
The world. So where he get rich from?
The world.
Excuse me, they got the money, where else you gonna get it from? That's why. And you're so busy working and carrying yours and giving it to the world. I don't want to tell you what you do to give it to them, but you do give it to them anyway. People don't know how to save, spend money. They don't know how to handle money. And they wonder why they broke, because you're busy giving it to people that's got more than you got. That's why. And then you wonder why you broke. Because you don't make good sense. You spend money. You have no regard for money. That's why God don't give. You don't have no regard for money. So anyway, I just wanted to get that over. I'm finished. I ain't fussing, I'm all. I want to get it over to you. Thank you, Diane. So now, where were we before? We're in Genesis 24, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's go back to Genesis 24 and 1. Because I want you to get this. I want you to know what's written the fourth time. It's written for your learning. You want to know what to do. Go back in the Bible and find out. And find out ain't nothing and nobody's important as God should be to you. And if they are, then you don't love God and you ain't walking by faith. You ain't telling the truth. You can't tell me because this Bible's right and everybody else is wrong. Right? I tell you, I love living this kind of life. Okay, precious. Okay, 21 and 24 and 1.
And Abraham was old and well stricken in age. And the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things.
Okay, now I want to drop down to verse 34 through 36.
And he said, I am Abraham's servant.
So now this is where Abraham is old and he's sending Eliezer, which is the type of the Holy Ghost. He's sending Eliezer for a bride for his wife, a bride for his son. Now God sent the Holy Ghost into the world for us who are the bride of Christ. Is that right?
Amen.
So that's what Eliezer is, the type of the Holy Ghost sent into the world to get Christ a wife.
Amen.
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 Okay, go ahead.
And the Lord had blessed my master greatly. And he has become great, and he hath given him flocks and herds and silver and gold and men servants and maid servants and camels and donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, bare the son to my master.
Yeah, he got all these camels. That's like having a Rolls Royce. Amen. He's got all these Rolls Royces. And he's got all these Mercedes. Are you here? He got a caravan of Mercedes.
Yeah,
and he's got caravans of Lexus. Are you hearing me? He's got BMWs. Are you hearing me? I mean, he just got it loaded up. And so my master got all of this stuff.
Amen.
So when you bring him back, your daughter going to be loaded. But before we go, we're going to give you so much stuff. Because he sent me with a camel. My camel's loaded.
Yeah.
With all these good things. Are you? He sent him loaded. Loaded. And when the Holy Ghost come to you, he came loaded. He came loaded with gifts. He came loaded with healing. He came loaded with prosperity. He came loaded from a Messiah. He came loaded with everything that God has. He came loaded. And he said, whatever you need, I got it. My master sent me Hallelujah. If you got depression, I got the opposite of depression. I got peace, I'll take your depression and give you peace. I come loaded. If you confused, I'll take your confusions and I'll give you a sound mind. I came loaded. If you got fear, I'll take your fear. Are you hearing me? And I'll make you bold as a lion. I came loaded. One clap. Y'all, you know, I wish I could take y'all pictures. But I'm so glad that God has already fixed me. Hallelujah. Glory. I've heard preach much less and got more response. But that's right. I don't need you to respond because I'm going to preach it anyhow. Okay, come on. What verse are you at?
In verse 36.
Okay.
And Sarah, my master's wife, bare the son to my master when she was old, and unto him have he given all that he had.
Now God gave Jesus all that he had.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? Because Isaac is a type of Christ. So God has given Jesus all that he was.
Amen.
And he has sent the Holy Ghost. He said, if I not go, the Holy Ghost won't come back. But he said it. But he went back and he sent back what? He sent back the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Am I an apostolic church?
Amen.
God help me, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. And so now I'm going to leave Abraham because we don't did enough in Abraham. Maybe we haven't did enough in Abraham. No. Let's get this one more with Abraham. Let's go to James, second chapter, 20 through 22. And then I'm going to move on to the one that failed God. Because we know Abraham passed every test that God presented him with. And so if Abraham can do it without the Holy Ghost, you can do it with the Holy Ghost. Is that true? Amen. So James 2, 20 through 22.
Amen. But will thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead?
You got to have some works. No. Listen, your singing, your shouting, and whatever is not works. It ain't what works. It's just making you feel good. But it ain't doing nothing for God. Come on, read.
Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he had offered Isaac, his son, upon the altar?
Was he justified? Yeah, he was justified. He was justified by faith. Faith justifies you. What's justifying you down here? If you ain't got faith, how could you be justified? Come on, read.
Verse 22. Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect.
Was faith made what?
Perfect.
You ain't got no works, your faith ain't perfect, so you might as well hang it up and forget it. If I see you coming in, when you got something you want to do real bad, and you don't do it, and you end up here instead of there, now your faith is showing me by your what? By your works. By your works, you are showing me. But if you put something before God and you don't show up, no. You're showing me where your faith is, wherever your heart is, there where your treasures be. So Abraham took his heart, he took his treasure, and he put it on the altar, and he offered it up to God.
Amen.
And the reason he did that is so that you could become heirs.
Amen.
Because if Abraham hadn't done it, God couldn't have did it either.
Amen.
And instead of you offering your... No. Let me take you. Let me go here. Let's go to Galatians, the third chapter. But let's hook it up, and then I'm finished with Abraham. I got a triple message here. These are the kind of messages I used to preach. I thought I was finished with preaching. I thought I was going to get a break today, but I didn't get one, so that's all right. Falling in love with Jesus, the best thing I ever done. Hallelujah! Falling in love with Jesus. It's the best thing I ever done. I want you to look at verse, look at verse 26. Read 26.
For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus.
Because you see, Christ Jesus, Jesus Christ is the seed that God promised to bless through Abraham. Okay, now drop down to verse 29.
And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise.
Whatever God promised Abraham, if you belong to Christ, you're heir to it.
Amen.
It belongs to you too. But oh my God, why don't you have it? It belongs to you too, but you got to get it by
faith.
Okay, so let's back up. Let me back up. All right, I tell you what. Let's back up verse 14. Read verse 14.
That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith.
That you might receive the promise of what?
The Spirit.
Through how?
Faith.
So how, and then drop down to 16, how are you going to have the promise of Abraham if you ain't got the faith to do what you need to do? You can't offer up. What are you offering up to God? What are you sacrificing for God? What are you turning loose for God that look like it's pulling your very heartstring out of your body? You're going to be tempted and you're going to be tried to turn loose what you want to do in order for God to do what he needs to do. Come on, read.
Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He said not, and to the seeds as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ.
It was only Christ. When he talked about the seed, he was talking about Christ. What Abraham did was he did what God done. Abraham was a type and a shadow of God, and Isaac was a type and a shadow of Jesus Christ, and Eliezer is a type and a shadow of the Holy Ghost. And so therefore, God, hallelujah to God, offered up his only son, Jesus Christ, for you and for I, because of Abraham, and because Abraham obeyed him, and then being offered up, then he sent back Eliezer with all the gifts, so that when he comes back, you'll be able to come back as his bride. Eliezer is going to bring you to Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
But it has to be by faith. And I'm looking at people and I see that, oh, I just don't understand how you do it. But I don't have to understand. You have to give an account. Because if this man could do all of this for you, hallelujah to God, without the Holy Ghost, what more should you able to do for God with the Holy Ghost? How much more should you be able to walk away from? How much should you be able to ignore? How much more should you be able to act like it don't exist? If that's what God said, I'll kill it. If God says kill it, I'll keep it alive. Are you here?
Amen.
All right. We're finished with Abraham. Now, I'm finished with him. Now I'm going to another segment. And I would like to ask you a question, but I don't think I'm about it. Let's go to 2 Samuel. And this is the opposite, 2 Samuel. People don't really know God. And I'm learning they don't know him. They've been in the building, but they ain't been in God. Because if they were in God, they couldn't treat God the way they treat him and be satisfied with their lives. It's impossible. It is totally impossible. Because you want to do everything you can to please him because you love him. And it ain't words in your mouth. It has to be actions in your life. Are y'all hearing me? Amen. It's going to take a sacrifice to please God. All right, this is Samuel, verse 21.
What chapter was it?
2 Samuel, chapter 24, verse 21. God made covenants with both of these men. Now, I ain't got time to go through covenant with David. But he told him a king would sit on his throne forever. Didn't he tell him that? Did he tell him that?
Yes.
So David was that one, right? Was that right?
Yes.
If y'all don't know it, I ain't going to try to explain it to you. We just come on. Come on, read.
And Araunah said, wherefore is my lord the king come to
wait a minute, wait a minute. Are you 2 Samuel 24 chapter?
21st verse.
24, 2 Samuel 24, 1. Come
and
on now.
And again the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he moved David against them to say, go number Israel and Judah. For the king said to Joab, the captain of the host, which was with him, go now through all the tribes of Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, and number ye the people, that I may know the number of the people. And Joab said unto the king, now the Lord thy God add unto the people, how many soever they be, an hundredfold, and that the eyes of my lord the king may see it. But why doth my lord the king delight in this thing?
But wait a minute, I haven't told you this in the first verse, but that's okay, that's all right, that's fine. But the thing of it is, he said the Lord moved him, right? Did he say it?
Yes.
Come on, let's read it together. And again, the anger of what?
The Lord was kindled against Israel.
And he moved David against them
to say, go number Israel and Judah.
But Joab told him it was wrong, right? So you know the Bible better enough. Was that God? No, it wasn't God. God had nothing to do with that one. It was a it's a misprint. It's a misprint, a misunderstanding, because God wouldn't do that.
Amen.
So now, to show you it's not God, and a lot of things y'all read that says it's God, it's not God, and it's not even biblically sound that it's God, but because you read it, you just take it for God anyhow. That's why you need revelation knowledge flowing out of your belly, and if you would do what you're supposed to do, out of your belly would flow revelation knowledge, that you wouldn't be confused over this word. Okay, let's go to 1 Chronicles 21st chapter. I mean, God can talk to you all night long, baby. He ain't got no problem. If you want to hear him. But if you got other things on your mind, other things you want to do, why should he talk to you? Why should he bother? When you got a worldly mind and a worldly attitude and a worldly connection and you more attached to this world, you got more soul ties in the natural than you have in the spirit. I don't know how you teach your families. I don't know how you do it. All right, are we ready?
Amen.
1 Chronicles 21, let's start reading.
And Satan stood up against Israel and provoked David to number Israel.
Who did it?
Satan.
Who did it?
Satan.
But the Samuel book said God did it, didn't it? It wasn't God. God had nothing to do with that. He allowed it, but he didn't do it because God would never do that.
Amen.
And Samuel said, that's God. No, you got to know the difference between God and the devil. But the Bible said it. Yeah, it said it. But the Bible said, all you'll get a what?
Understanding.
Okay, now, so since we're going to read it, okay, you read all the way to the fourth verse in this one. Come on.
Verse 2. And David said to Joab and to the rulers of the people, go number Israel from Beersheba even to Dan, and bring the number of them to me that I may know it. 3. And Joab answered, the Lord make his people 100 times so many more as they be. But my lord the king, are they not all my lord's servants? Why then doth my lord require this thing? Why will he be a cause of trespass to Israel?
He's telling the king, you're sinning by doing this. But the king has the last word. And so therefore, Joab moves partly. Come on, read.
Verse 4. Nevertheless, the king's word prevailed against Joab. Wherefore Joab departed and went throughout all Israel, and came to Jerusalem.
Okay, so now he went, he didn't count them all because his heart was, he just knew the king was wrong, so he didn't count them all, he just counted some of them. Oh, you got that? Now drop down from 7 through 8.
Verse 7, and God was displeased with this thing.
So God had nothing to do with it, right? God was displeased with it, but Judah read in Samuel and said God did it. No, he didn't. And there's some things you're doing in your life, people say, God said that you ain't telling the truth, and I know you ain't telling the truth. You ain't going to tell me that because I know better.
Amen.
Come on, move. Read.
Verse 8, and David said unto God, I have sinned greatly because I have done this thing. But now I beseech thee, do away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly. Amen.
Okay, what did you read down to verse 7? Now drop down to verse 14.
Verse 14, amen. So the Lord sent pestilence upon Israel, and there fell of Israel 70,000 men.
70,000 men, because he made one decision. Abraham made the right decision, and my God, look how many are going to be blessed. Look how many are going to be saved, because he stood the test. When you mess up in your families, how many people are going to pay for your mess up? David knew he messed up. You can't undo what's done. Okay, drop down to verse 17.
Amen. And David said unto God, is it not I that commanded the people to be numbered? Even I it is that have sinned and done evil. Indeed, but as for these sheep, what have they done?
They ain't done nothing. Innocent people are going to die because the headship didn't do it right. Come on.
Let thine hand, I pray thee, O Lord my God, be on me and on my father's house.
Oh my God, he's bringing on his own family's house. They ain't had nothing to do with it either, did they? One decision made by one man All these people are dying, and you know David's life, this family's life is a wreck. Come on, read.
Let thine hand, I pray thee, O Lord my God, be on me and on my father's house, but not on thy people, that they should be plagued.
Okay, that they should be plagued. Now, people of God, I want to take you to two scriptures. I'm finished. Let's go to James, the first chapter of James. No, the first chapter of James, 12 through 15. It is. I keep telling people, you don't sin alone. My God, you don't. I keep telling them, I tell people that you don't sin alone. You don't sin alone. This is new. You do not sin alone. You need to think about your actions. Somebody is going to reap the repercussions of what you do and what you say. Somebody might escape, but somebody going to pay. And if this ain't Bible, we might as well close the book and go home. That's why I told you to go to Ephesians. It was done before, and you're going to recycle it and do it again. But Abraham recycled it, and Abraham did it, and Jesus Christ came under the unction of the Father and recycled it right. Amen. But David messed up, and people will come right behind David and do the
same.
So as good as recycled, so is evil recycled. Okay, are we ready to read James?
Amen.
Amen.
Blessed is the man that endureth temptation.
Now, blessed is the man that endureth what?
Temptation.
Blessed is the man that endureth it. He endured. Abraham endured, didn't he?
Amen.
So he's a blessed man, right?
Amen.
Blessed Abraham. Abraham, so therefore in your 28th chapter, you got all these blessings because of Father Abraham. You got all these blessings.
Amen.
You ain't got them because of what David did.
Amen.
Okay, come on, read.
Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempt he any man.
See, God can't be tempted with evil, so he doesn't tempt you with evil, but he does tempt you with tests and trials so that you can be blessed.
Amen.
So don't get it mixed up. Oh, God didn't do it. Yes, he did. Yes, he did. And when he did it, now he says, I know. Because the angel spoke to him, so God was in that, right?
Amen.
So he was tempted. You're going to be tempted, and so am I. We're all going to be tempted. Okay, read.
Verse 14.
But 15, already 15.
But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Verse 15. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death.
So when David got finished doing what he was doing, what did it bring forth?
Death.
And all those people's lives, it brought for what?
Death.
It brought for, he still lived, but they dead. He couldn't bring them back. And you don't, I'm not trying to make you feel bad. I'm trying to give you information.
Amen.
I'm trying to give you, okay, read it in the Amplified, Brother Reed. And then Diane, you read it. I want y'all to hear this over and over again. People, you need to think about what you do before you do it, and you need to pray about what you do before you do it. You need to understand there are consequences to your actions. Go ahead.
Blessed, happy, to be envied is the man who is patient under trial and stands up under temptation.
Abraham never talked back. He rose early in the morning, and he did it.
Amen.
Come on.
For when he has stood the test and have been approved, he will receive the victor's crown of life.
He has to be what? Approved? You got to be approved, people. You don't get things contingent without being approved. You got to be approved. Come on, read.
He will, and test and been approved, he will receive the victor's crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say, when he is tempted, I am tempted from God. For God is incapable of being tempted by what is evil, and he himself tempts no one. But every person is tempted when he is drawn away, enticed, and baited by his own evil desire, lust, passions. Verse 15. Then the evil desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully matured, brings forth death.
People are dying in so many ways. They're dying. and we're helping them die, and we don't have sense enough to know that we're helping them to die. But we see dead things in their lives, and we don't know how to resurrect it, because you done killed something that you can't resurrect. Only God can resurrect what you done killed. Because he is the resurrection. We are not resurrected. It is Christ. So watch how you do things with people and with your children, with your family, because you're killing things in them. And then you wonder why they're like they are, because you done killed something that you should have been nurturing and making grow and teaching that child to be more than what they ought to be as far as they think they should be. Because they can have a thought, but you're supposed to take them like an arrow and shoot them beyond their thoughts. That's a parent's job. That's why God told them to honor you, because you're like a God to them. But some people, to God be the glory for the things he has done. Okay, Diane, read it.
12. God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Afterward, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. And remember, when you are being tempted, do not say, God is tempting me. God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone else. Temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. These desires give birth to sinful actions, and when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death.
All right, read 16.
So don't be misled, my dear brothers and sisters.
Go ahead.
Whatever is good and perfect comes down to us from God our Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow.
So God always does what's right. He doesn't variate from right to wrong. No, he doesn't do that. He does what's right. So now I'm going to read this last one here. They're going to read this. Because people got excuses. I did this because I was sad. I did this because I was depressed. I don't care. I just did this because I didn't know nobody. You got all of these excuses. But didn't I tell you on Friday and I let you read me all nails across? Amen. Thou art inexcusable, whoever you are. Is that what it says?
Amen.
So you don't add no excuses to me, because you know I ain't going to accept them. Because this scripture has helped me to be anchored for umpteen years. And if it did it for me, he loves you just like he loves me, it can anchor you too.
Amen.
Let's go to 1 Corinthians 10 and 12. It can do it for you if it did it for me. I done been through the wind, the rain, and the storm. I'm on my shire, but I thank God I'm like Job. I'm going to come out as gold. I am going to come out as gold. Because you see, this is really talking about the children in the wilderness. Okay, read the 12th verse, and we're going to back up after you read it.
Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall.
Go ahead, keep reading.
There have no temptation taken you, but such as common to man. But God is faithful.
Who's faithful?
God.
Who's faithful?
God.
So therefore, you don't have no excuse, do you?
Amen.
Come on, God is faithful, go ahead.
Who will not suffer you to be tempted.
God will not allow you to be tempted. If you can't handle it, God won't let it happen. If God let it happen, it's because his grace is sufficient for you, his strength is made perfect in your weakness, and you can handle it because God is there to stand up in you and to make sure you don't fall. You did it because you wanted to. There is no temptation that taketh a man, but that was his comment. But God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted. About that you're able. Because God, with the temptation, will make a way for you to what? Escape that you will be able to what? To bear. You didn't want to bear it.
Hallelujah.
So then you want to put it on God. Never, ever would you ever think you can do that. Because I've been through too many things, and this scripture has sustained me day and night. God, you are not me. God, you're able. Now what you going to do with this? What you going to tell God? Go ahead, read it all with me.
There has no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God, who is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will, with the temptation, also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it.
Okay, doing the Amplified, and you do it, because I want y'all to get this in your spirit. Now, don't come to me with these crutchy things, because I will knock the crutches out from under you. Because this Bible did it before I got there. And my position is to help you to grow up and not be a cripple. God didn't die for cripples to stay crippled. He died for cripples to deliver them from being crippled. Okay, come on, read.
Therefore, let anyone who thinks he stands, who feels sure that he is, that he has a steadfast mind and is standing firm, take heed lest he fall into sin. Verse 13. For no temptation, no trial, regarded as enticing to sin, no matter how it comes or where it leads, has overtaken you and laid hold on you. There that is not common to man. That is, no temptation or trial has come to you that is beyond human resistance, and that it is not adjusted and adapt and belonging to human experience, and such as man can bear. But God is faithful to his word and to his compassionate nature, and he can be trusted.
Who can be trusted?
God can.
Who can be trusted?
God can.
Don't trust yourself. You trust who?
God.
He can be trusted. Come on.
And he can be trusted not to let you be tempted and tried and assayed by your ability and strength of resistance and power to endure. But with the temptation, he will always also.
He will always?
Yes, always.
He will always?
Always.
He will always?
Always.
He will always?
Always.
What will he do?
Always also provide the way out, the means of escape to a landing place, that you may be capable and strong and powerful.
No, you're going to be weak, falling down, getting up, pitiful, and crying.
Strong.
You're going to have problems. You're going to walk around looking like you're mad. You're going to walk around like you're in outer space. You're going to walk around looking like you don't know. I got one person telling me, I just don't know what to do. I just know something about to take them and shake them. I ain't going to call them names. But they probably smiling at me right now. but I don't know. Yes, you do. Read the book. It told you what to do.
Amen.
What do you mean you don't know what to do? Yes, you do. And the thing of it is, if you think I'm the only one that I'm talking to, you need to go home.
Amen.
You really do, because you're pitiful. I'm talking to everybody in here.
Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Everybody in here. They don't want one or two people. I'm talking to a lot of people.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, you finished?
Nope. That you may be capable and strong and powerful to bear up under it patiently.
How?
Patiently.
Like Job and Abraham were counterparts. One was faith and one was patience.
Amen.
Amen. And the twin never met, but they were both counterparts.
Amen.
You know, God didn't let two strong people get together.
Amen.
You know, I'm telling you, God is awesome, ain't he?
Yes.
If he wants you to suffer alone, he knows how to do it. And you have somebody right there that you can help you, talk to you, and comfort you. No, he sent him the crippled people. Yes, he did. He sent Job the crippled people who literally tantalized his life and made everything he did was right make him look wrong. He didn't have no help. And God stood back and watched him all that time, didn't he?
Amen.
Did he watch him?
Yes, he did.
The bad people, Job was so aggravated, he cussed the day he was born.
Yes.
God still didn't say a word. You can't beat God being silent. Come on, Diane. This is the last one.
Okay. If you think you are standing strong, be careful not to fall. The temptation in your life are no different from what others experience.
Hey, so why do you think you're so special that you got something going in your life and winning somebody else's? What makes you think your case so different? Because you got a pity party and pity yourself. That's why you ain't different from nobody else. We all in this world. We all going through tests. Pastor, you don't like you tested and tried. Are you out of your mind? You all test me and try me. I mean, y'all do a whole lot of testing and a whole lot of trying. And God do, I got to do a whole lot of proving that I trust you. So I don't know what you're talking about. Come on, read.
When God is faithful, he will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. When you are tempted, he will show you a way out so that you can endure.
He will show you a way out so that you can endure. I want you to get that, to know greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You have no right losing. You have no right to lose. You have every right to win. You have no right to be defeated. You are the defeater. You defeat the enemy. You have no right. Listen, if you don't know how to raise your kids, you don't know how to train, get in this book and keep reading until God gives you some wisdom and some knowledge. Stay up some nights. Turn your plate down like you really care about your family, like you really care about God. Turn your plate down and stop eating so much. I got sugar. I don't care if you got high blood pressure. You can go half a day. Amen. Are you hearing me? Amen. Because God is able. He's able. He's able. How can you do so much when the doctors tell you, but you can't do nothing? God tell you. You're creeping around. But you can get up and go to doctors. If you can get up and go to doctors, you can go to church.
Amen.
If you go to doctors in the hot heat of the day, you come to church in the hot heat of the day. You unblessed person. I'm watching what I'm saying. And yes, I think about it. And yes, I'm frustrated, but I ain't no more because God told me don't let myself be agitated. But I can't understand how God is so good to you. You go to doctors and clinics and therapy in the daytime, and you can't come to church in the daytime. You can't come to prayer. You ain't serious. So why am I crying out praying for you? You ought to be here doing it for yourself and thanking God. Are you hearing me? Get my message nice and clear, because I ain't taking it back. I'm not taking it back. If you got me praying for you and God is blessing you and God is living you, and I'm a preacher and a pastor and I'm in here every time there's prayer on Monday and Tuesday praying, God bless them, God help them, where is your face in the place?
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
And if you're tired of coming, then pastor, stop praying for me because I don't want to do it no more. No problem, baby. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
And if you think I'm joking, I ain't going to take it back. I don't care who you are. I mean just what I said. You ought to thank God enough that somebody thinks enough of you, they care enough about it. Because one time nobody did.
Yes.
Right. Yes. And now you got somebody to do. And they praying for you. And where are you? I don't care what you tell me. You ain't got nobody to stay at home. I don't care what you say. Cancer, sick, I come in here anyway. You see me do it.
Amen.
I never missed when I got up out of the grass. Drove me. I didn't have nobody to call asking, pastor, can I bring you to church? Nobody came out there to park my car. I parked my own car. I walked in this church myself as a woman, and don't you hand me that junk, because I won't take it.
Amen.
And I'll stand on it until Jesus comes.
Amen.
You gotta fight.
Yes.
You gotta fight.
Yes.
You gotta fight. If you want to be delivered, you gotta fight. If you want to overcome, you gotta fight to show that you are living by faith. You have to fight yourself. You gotta fight your feelings. You gotta fight your emotions. You gotta fight your appetite. You gotta fight the way you want to treat people. You gotta fight the way people treat you. You got to fight.
Oh, yeah.
And you gotta fight the thoughts that God allows the devil to put in your head too. Because baby, they come. You better believe they come. Why are you fooling around with them? Why you see they ain't getting no better? Why don't you do this? Hey, glory to God. God, you told me to cast down imaginations. Everything that exalts itself against what this Bible said, I'm going to cast it down. But oh, they get away. They don't pay tithes. Why don't you get away? Because I ain't crazy. God said, if you don't pay tithes, you rob God. Would a man rob God? No, because if I rob God, the devil gonna rob me. Are you hearing me? He gonna rob me. And you can rob God in your time. Are you hearing me? If you can put one foot ahead of the other, I'm expecting to see you coming in the door with one foot ahead of the other. If I'm your example, you follow me as I follow Christ, you can do it too. I don't care if they get angry with me. You know, I don't care because I know what I've been doing. I know what I've been trying. I know the times I went before God and you wouldn't have made it. But God said, the prayers of the righteous, the prayers of the righteous, the prayers of the righteous avail us. And you man out all for God help them. God deliver them. God bless them. God give them one more time. I know they didn't do it right. I know they absolutely ignored you, God. I know they didn't care about you. They cared more about themselves when they wanted it every time. But my God, have mercy. God told the preacher to cry out between the porch and the altar before for his people. And I remember the scripture.
Amen.
But maybe you got a job too.
Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
And some of y'all been preachers, and I ain't never seen such preachers act like some of these preachers have been preaching in all the days of my life.
Amen.
How in the name of God could you lead people and act like you act?
Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Would I love the pastor me? I'd love the pastor me. I'd love me. Yes, I would. Dr. Jensen asked you a question. Would you love the pastor you? I said, yes, I'd love the pastor me. Because when the pastor from Refuge came, he said, I'd have never let you go. Because if you're a worker, baby, you're a worker. And you don't mind getting up underneath the load pushing anybody. You'll push anybody, anybody, anybody. That's what you'll push them. Why? Because you're a worker. You ain't stingy. Are you hearing me? And I worked in refuge. I wasn't a couch potato or slouching. I worked and put good time and money in it.
Amen.
Are y'all hearing me?
Amen.
Now, if you want to meet me outside, I'll meet you outside. And I ain't carrying nobody with me but Jesus this time either. I ain't carrying Andre. I ain't carrying Lamont, whatever, whichever, however. I'm going to meet you with J-E-S-U-S. And look you in your face and tell you, say it if you want to, and it's your last breath. Meet me, baby, because I got a God that stands high and looks low. I'm telling you, you don't use God. He's not your yo-yo. Now I'm finished. Now I got a story to tell about me and Diane. You can cut it off.